you. So my paper is entitled "By Juice Being an Event: An Ontological Translation of the Early Work." As maybe became clear out of my question yesterday, my approach to "By Juice" work is more historical. And starts in the first place from theory of the subject, more than all the mathematical stuff. So I hope you forgive me for that in the context of this master class. First of all, I want to say that this conference paper is one particular part of a bigger argument, in this version modified in order to make a point concerning Bayeux's ontology and the role of the event. In a very short version, the argument of this broader paper starts from Bayeux's assertion that philosophy is unable to produce philosophical truth itself and is therefore conditioned by some privileged domains as laid out most clearly in the book Conditions, and as he said also this morning. And specifically related to the early work in which subjectivity is always already political, it is impossible for philosophy to produce political truths. Nevertheless, following the same scheme, I argued that the whole of Bayeux's philosophical system can be understood as a reflective moment upon the political truths he is faithful to himself, that is, those truths that arise in the aftermath of 68. From there, it is my aim to examine the thesis that, therefore, his political aims are inscribed in the formal structure of his entire philosophical system, in particular in the figure of the subject. However, I will not talk about this today. Consequently, if I want to show that this is not only the case for the early work, most importantly theory of the subject, but for being an event as well, I have to somehow argue for the continuity between both works. I think this question of continuity touches upon an issue that is already extensively discussed between those who prefer the mathematical aspect and those who favor the political aspect of Bayeux's work. Therefore, in restraining myself to the passage from theory of the subject to being an event, I will examine in my paper today the thesis that the latter can be considered an attempt to ontologically translate the work done in the former book. From within this hypothesis, I will both relate to those aspects in which Bayeux seems to confirm this thesis and those in which something new or modified seems to arise. Moreover, my paper attempts to question this thesis from within a framework that asks what it means to shift from the logical, more historical context of theory of the subject to the explicit mathematical ontological context of being an event, what Bosdales has called Bayeux's mathematical turn. In order to do so, I propose to consider three significant moments in his work. In the first moment, I will investigate what Bayeux in particular understands when speaking about ontology in theory of the subject. And in the second moment, I will consider how this has changed at the beginning of being an event and what this implies. Eventually, in the third moment, I will come to evaluate Bayeux's self-declared beyond Lacan at the very ending of the latter book. In all three moments, the elaboration of the question of the subject proves to be central, first as a political forced figure and then ontologically as a trace of the event. And the first moment is called So Little Ontology, which is a quote from Theory of the Subject. In Theory of the Subject, it is important to note that the ontological question is embedded in the militant political motifs of this book, insofar as it can be considered an attempt to put a Lacanian legacy in function of an emancipative political project. Its ontological dimension will be as well inspired by Lacan's particular consideration of ontology. In Seminar 11, Lacan, instigated by Millet's question on the ontological status of the unconscious, says that, and I quote, "Psychoanalysis is neither a Weltanschauung nor a philosophy that claims to provide the key to the universe. It is governed by a particular aim, which is historically defined by the elaboration of the notion of the subject." And end of quote. In theory of the subject, Bayeux will maintain the same prudence, or as he says himself, modesty, as Lacan when speaking of his ontology. Because both Bayeux's theory of the subject and Lacanian psychoanalysis are centered upon an elaboration of the subjective, their consideration of ontology cannot be regarded separately from this notion. In theory of the subject, Bayeux gives two definitions that will correspond to this reading of the Lacanian legacy, and moreover, and I quote, oppose one another. the subject is consistent, the first definition, the subject is a consistent repetition in which the real exists, which is the definition of Lacan, and then the second is the subject is a destructive consistency in which the real exceeds, end of quote. In the first characterization, the emphasis is laid upon the repetitive dynamics wherein the subject is only determined by its structural placing. In the second definition, rather the ability of the subject to exceed this place is considered. It may be clear that the particular way in which Badiou attempts to reconcile both aspects, that is, converts Lacan's subject of the unconscious into a subject of force, serves this political interest. Although the first definition of the subject is central to Lacanian theory, which is in the very first place a clinical theory, the second is much more controversial in relation to what Lacan aimed at himself. However, the argumented theory of the subject claims to find Lacan at a certain point hinting at this. According to the gap in between both definitions, Badiou distinguishes between the Lacanian writings, both the seminars and the écrits, up until the 1960s, and those from 1970 on. In its most general form, the early writings follow the first definition, in which logic is put to work that can best be described as, and I quote Lacan here, and what one gains on one side, one loses on the other. Not knowing what one has lost, one believes to have won. And end of quote. In this characterization of the early Lacan, the perspective of a structure that repeats itself is always privileged. The inability to exceed the space of placement is characterized by the operational possibilities within this space. I quote, the operations of this place are substitutions, metaphor and metonymy. End of quote. A purely structural conception of the subject that always outbalances its loss and gain, therefore, would designate in political terms a conservative stance that proves itself unable to serve the militant purposes of theory of the subject. However, the second Lacan, still according to Badiou, of course hints at the primacy of the historical over the structural by focusing on the real opened up by the impasse of formalization. It is the supplementation of the famous Lacanian statement from summer 20 that can be considered the core of theory of the subject's theoretical ambitions. The impasse of formalization must designate as well a pass of the subject. In its exact formulation, it becomes clear how urgent this emancipatory political project was for Badiou at the time. And I quote, the algorithm system determination limit, with its deviations to the right and to the left, is a truth of a structural dialectical sequence, but only up to the point where this impeccable formalism is summed up in the do not trespass that orders a return. We need a theory of the path of the real and the breach opened up by formalization. Here the real is no longer what can be lacking from its place, but what passes through by force. End of quote. I propose to read in the we need, in the quote, Badiou's urgency for a political engagement that exceeds the Lacanian structural dialectic in order to be able to think the revolutionary events of 68. It is this, in the reflective moment after the production of the political truths of these events, that this political engagement became to condition the articulation of a subject of force, and moreover the formal structure of this philosophical system. And this claim has, of course, be argued further. In ontological terms, according to Badiou, this shift concerns the transition from an ontology centered upon the lack of being to one that attempts to think the being of the lack. The discussion of the location of the lack will return in the final chapter of Being and Event, when Badiou is discussing Descartes and Lacan. Considering Lacan's definition of the subject's desire as the metonymy of lack of being, Badiou remarks that in describing the subject this way, I quote, Lacan gives himself an access road into ontology. The unconscious is that being which subverts the metaphysical opposition of being and non-being. End of quote. Badiou further develops this by pointing at the similarities between the roles of the unconscious in psychoanalysis and the proletariat in Marxist politics. In both cases, the role can be considered, and I quote, a prohibition that brings to being an existent in spite of its non-advent. End of quote, in the words of Lacan, of course. Their ontological status is always that of a hypothesis. Its being has to be presupposed first. The ontological question is therefore made conditional on the elaboration of a specific theory. An ontology centered upon a lack of being, in which the lack is not recognized as such, is this characteristic for what Badiou has called the structural dialectic of the first Lacan. It is an ontology in which the lack is metonymically covered. Being is always, and I quote, being placed in a position of vanishing as to the object and of dispersion repetition as to the subject. End of quote. In contrast, Badiou believes that it is possible to go beyond this balance of gain and loss Lacan was witnessing from a clinical point of view. Even stronger, in order to be able to think of revolutionary politics, Badiou is obliged to go beyond and think of this being of lack as an excessive mastery of loss. The name for this process that is absolutely central to the subject and for the early work in general is destruction. Being is set as, and I quote, being forced in a position of destruction as to the object, of access as to the subject. The way in which theory of the subject thinks ontology is centered upon the transition of ordinarily being placed to the political possibility of being forced. The revolutionary move for this transition resides in providing ontological consistency for the lack, that is, affirming its destructive capacity instead of repeatedly covering it. Therefore, Badiou mobilizes both the first and the second Lacan. And I quote, to define the subject as the metonymy of the lack of being only identifies half of its essence. The other half being that which gives being to the lack, that is destruction, which is irreducible to the act of pure substitution. According to both halves, end of quote. According to both halves, being is the set as either being placed or being forced. It brings Badiou to speak into the subject of so little ontology. the second moment is called the hypothesis of a mathematical regulation of the ontological question, which is a quote from Being and Event in the very last page. a second significant moment concerning the question of ontology along the work of Badiou is, of course, the axiomatic decision at the beginning of Being and Event. The decision that ontology equals mathematics is the hypothesis on which the whole of the investigation of Being and Event hinges. The status of this inaugural axiom shows, therefore, a totally different approach to ontology than maintained in theory of the subject. In the introduction to the English translation of 2005, after having clarified the main thesis of the book, Badiou makes clear the status of this decision. this is a quote, "I attempted to argue for this thesis and link them together in a coherent manner. This much I have said. What is more, I placed a rather sophisticated mathematical apparatus at her service. To take the infinity of pure multiples, I took tools from Cantor's set theory. To take the generic character of truths, I turned to Gödel and Cohen's profound thinking of what a part of a multiple is. And I support this intervention of mathematical formalism with a radical thesis. Insofar as being qua being is nothing other than pure multiplicity, it is legitimate to say that ontology, the science of being qua being, is nothing other than mathematics itself."
That's about a quarter.
Sorry?
That's about 15 minutes gone.
Okay, thank you.
5 minutes or so, maybe.
And I think in this quotation it becomes clear that the intervention of mathematical formalism can be said to provide an ontological basis that serves the grounding of something else. In the light of my argument, this would be his theory of the subject that was already articulated in 1982. Therefore, from within what he calls, on the very last page of Being an Event, the hypothesis of a mathematical regulation of the ontological question, it must be possible to give some indications or arguments for the understanding of Being an Event as an attempt to translate theory of the subject in an ontological setting. First, the tension between belonging, appartenance, and inclusion plays out to delineate the relation between being and void, echoes very clearly the tension between structure and lack in theory of the subject, and moreover in famous structuralist discussions of the 1960s. That is, for example, the case for the project of the cahier pour l'analyse that can be considered the consequent examination of the statement that the structure implies the subject. Being an event, concept of the void that does not belong but is included in a historical situation reframes the distinction between the structural and historical aspects of the dialectic deployed in theory of the subject. Moreover, from a genealogical perspective, it seems possible to understand all of Badiou's philosophical work as instigated by a single question. And we'll refer to this, like also yesterday. So I will not read the quote. The repetition of the tension structural like subject as the ontological triad being void event witnesses the insistence of this question, namely that the whole of the system is instigated by a single question, which is the question of change and novelty. Okay, maybe I'll skip a bit. Moreover, in both books, the articulation of the question of novelty consists in two aspects that serve the very same purposes. In book 5, Being an Event, Badiou admits that, and I quote, one can actually recognize in what I then, in terms of the subject, I term subjectivization, the group of concepts as attached to intervention, and in what I named the subjective process, the concept attached to fidelity. An obvious difference, however, is the fact that subjectivization and subjective process are dimensions of the subject, while intervention and fidelity concern subjective aspects of the event. I will come back on this in my third significant moment. What concerns the coupling of subjectivization and intervention, the idea is in both cases that there is a sudden interruption of the repetitive dynamics of a structured situation. In the language of the subject, this rupture is caused by the real opened up or formalization breaks down. It is the time of insurrection, the primacy of force over place. In Being an Event, the intervention is the denomination of the unpresented of historical sites, the illegal circulation of an eventual multiple, a decision on the basis of the undecidable, a diagonal of the situation. The designated similarity between the subjective process and the procedure of fidelity concerns the organizing process character of subjective or eventual change. Badiou speaks in theory of the subject of the forced possibility of the real as consistency, emphasizing the subjective process, emphasizing that the subjective process exists only in the recomposition of the consequences in light of the interruption. And Being an Event, he speaks about fidelity as a discipline of time, which controls from beginning to end the consequences of the introduction into circulation of the paradoxical multiple. Crucial, therefore, is the issue of temporality. But maybe I'll not go into that. So in this second moment, I have pointed at some indications for the continuity between theory of the subject and Being an Event. Okay. And then the third moment is called the event of subject au-delà de Lacan, so beyond Lacan. I would designate as the third significant moment in the last chapter of Being an Event, in which Badiou claims to go beyond Descartes and Lacan. This chapter explicitly goes back to theory of the subject while implicitly referring to Lacan's La science et la vérité, Science and Truth, the latter text published in 1966 in the first volume of the Cahier pour l'analyse, questions the relation between truth and knowledge, starting from the thesis that the subject of psychoanalysis is nothing but the subject of modern science. In this chapter, Badiou claims that the ontological issues Descartes, Lacan, and himself have discussed address fundamentally the location of the void. The idea of Badiou is the following, and I quote, what still attaches Lacan to the Cartesian epoch of science is the thought that the subject must be maintained in the pure void of its subtraction if one wishes to save truth. In contrast, referring to his own work on the event, Badiou subverts the Lacanian understanding of the category of truth by stating that, and I quote, what Lacan lacked is a radical suspension of truth from the supplementation of a being in situation by an event which is a separator of the void, end of quote. Whereas the Lacanian split subject remains a figure that via its desire stands in for a structural lack, the relation between the Badiouan eventual subject and the void is mediated by the occurrence of the event. He elucidates this difference once more by a kind of inversion of categories. I will displace the subject on the side of the ultra one, the void on the side of being, and truth on the side of the indiscernible. End of quote. Hence, it may be clear that most of the difference between Badiou's interpretation of Lacan, theory of the subject and being an event, is made by his desire to put the event at the central stage. The main claim of this third moment will therefore be that the central feature to understand Badiou's or de Lacan is his articulation of the event with subject. Still in the same last chapter of being an event, Badiou reframes the discussion with Lacan in theory of the subject in relation to his ontological articulation of the event. And I quote, the choice is either between a structural recurrence, which thinks the subject effect as a void set, and a hypothesis of the rarity of the subject, which suspends its occurrence from the event, from the intervention, and from the generic paths of fidelity, both returning the void to a function of suture to being. End of quote. Although both options situate the void on the side of being, what differs is the evidence of the subject's occurrence. Badiou blames Lacan for defending a notion of the subject that still can be considered ontologically foundational because of, I quote, the supposition of its structural permanence. For Badiou, this is the very same gesture as the ontological grounding of the Cartesian cogito in its logical form, its empty and apodictic transference. In opposition to this, Badiou articulates the subject as a rarity. Maybe I will not go into that because that's a lot about it. So to summarize, the rearticulation of early word concepts, in particular the notion of the subject, takes place in light of the systematic ontological elaboration of the event and being an event. The core of Badiou's subject articulation had shifted from both metonymy of lack and possibility of forced excess in terms of the subject to a figure intimately connected to the event in being an event. It now functions as what unifies the event's two essential moments, the interpretative intervention and the procedure of fidelity. Hence, whereas in theory of the subject, the event is still a primitive stage in the guise of force, as Bostils has argued, Badiou says, and I quote, the event trace of the subject crosses the lack with the destruction, while in being an event, the roles are inversed, with the subject that is considered a local trace of the event, this time explicitly pointing at the shift from a logical and historical greater than ontological context to being an event, but you therefore states, and I quote, however, the order of reasons is this time that of a foundation. This is why the category of the subject, which in my previous book, Theory of the Subject, immediately followed the elucidation of dialectical logic, arises in the strict sense, lost it, there is something wrong. Okay, then I'll just conclude. So examining the claim that being an event can be considered an ontological translation of the work done in theory of the subject, that is evaluating the attempt to provide an ontological basis for a theory of the subject, I considered in this paper three significant moments along Badiou's work. Although my specific analysis has provided some evidence in the direction of this claim, the formal articulation of the subject itself seems to have changed quite a bit. From politically crucial in order to think and force revolutionary politics to an ontologically rare trace, a mere function of the event. As it is my underlying motivation to understand the whole of Badiou's work as a relevant unity, I am tempted to argue for the claim that the differences between both Badiou and subjective figures can be traced back to the mentioned shift in context alone. After all, it was my original idea to consider the differences identified as not necessarily exceeding the idea of Badiou's work as an increasingly purified system, following a single idea, although crossing different philosophical territories, moments, and modalities. As both subject articulations are, in my opinion, still faithful answers to the problem of subjective change and novelty, I remain somehow convicted that the subject of being an event reverse the very core of its political variant, a theory of the subject, that is, a formal figure designed to inform revolutionary action. Nevertheless, for now, I would like to leave open the question and consider this paper a contribution to the ongoing discussions circling around the issue of continuity between early and later work. So maybe in the light of this paper, these discussions become a bit less polarized in the end.
questions or points, please?
Please. I think, so I appreciate the fact that you're trying to lessen the polarization between either the historical or the mathematical badge. I think that's really important. And I think that the early discussion between Peter and Bruno was thoroughly mistaken, actually, because neither of them are paying attention to the concept of modeling, in which Badiou's fundamental concern is with mathematics. So there's no mathematical concern because he starts in mathematics. He forgets it for a while, or he doesn't pay as much attention to it, even though it's already a theory of the subject. But what he's concerned with in the concept of modeling is the historicity of mathematics. So it's actually thinking the structure of the historicization of mathematics through the emergence of axiom systems that formalize working mathematicians' practices. So there, so what you actually have in that text is a collapse of any opposition between, you know, a historical period in his thinking and a mathematical period in his thinking, because he's trying to think both of them together. And in, you know, mathematics, in, to a certain extent, is like a proving ground for the most rigorous possible thinking of historical change.
I could agree on that, I think, but as I was maybe it's the same question I had yesterday, that I haven't read the concept of the model, but for me it's clear that this is maybe more a question of formalism than a question of mathematics, but I don't know if there is would be like a real difference. So I know that like his very first articles were in the Cahiers pour l'analyse, I think at the end of the 50s or something, and they're about mathematics, like only about mathematics. And then the text, I haven't read the text itself, but I've read an interview wherein he states that the concept of a model was like a seminar that was given like in April 68 or something, and then it was fine to talk about these things, but after May 68 it was impossible at first to publish this text because everything had to be political. They couldn't like let it inside in some kind. So I don't know what I'm trying to say. yeah, but maybe it's true that like the mathematical term, that this notion of Bastiat has to be nuanced.
Nuanced, yeah.
Mm. Okay, thank you.
I think you're arguing that history itself imposed the category of history from 68 onwards.
I don't understand.
Well, because May 68 happens, and that's why the editors, that's why he wrote his preface where it was denounced as a theoreticist deviation. So it was, the context made it far less receivable as a piece of philosophy. And there was actually, there was a turn to history, actually, as of May 68,
okay.
That's what I would add.
I thought the paper was quite interesting, especially in light of some of the things that Badiou was saying sort of yesterday. One of the things especially that he said yesterday, of course, was that mathematics, in response to your question, was that, you know, he uses mathematics in order to get precise definitions, rather than need something more kind of like more sort of fundamental than that. And I think you see that. I mean, in theory, the subject, for example, it's not like there's no mathematics in it. There's lots of mathematics, but you can argue a lot more convincingly that those uses of mathematics are allegorical and used in order for illustrative purposes. Whereas you're correct, and when you get to being in the event, you can no longer read the mathematics as being allegorical, or you can. You have to argue it a lot more.
Mm-hmm.
So I find it very interesting, this sort of idea that in a sense, you want to go back to theory of the subject, because I think you're correct in a way that there's more in theory of the subject that is formally cashed out in being an event. And to a certain extent, I think that's what Badiou was saying yesterday when he was talking about where his work is going on from from now on with the stuff on paraconsistent logic, it's almost as if he's going back to some of those aspects in theory of the subject which haven't yet been cashed out formally. Mm-hmm. So I think there is something sort of rich there to be done in that sort of to-ing and fro-ing between the texts. It's not like a simple progression, like you know, being an event is better than theory of the subject and or any sort of progression like that, but a constant sort of dialectical play between them. I think that's really what I wanted to say, because when you go and look at theory of the subject, what you find at the end is this notion of confidence, which is the intertwining of what he calls psi and alpha, of anxiety and the superego and all those sort of terms. Mm-hmm. And what you find there, in a sense, is a very descriptive account of what it is to be a faithful subject. It says, you know, it's just this notion of confidence, which is this awful kind of experience of anxiety and courage, justice and things like that intertwined. There's no formal rule for it. There's no way in which you can sort of do that. And I think, if you like, the main purpose of being an event is, I think you're correct, is to explain that, not just express it, not just express that notion of being a faithful subject, but to explain it. And the mathematics is brought in to provide those precise definitions. So when you get to the end of theory of the subject, there's a lot of discussion of confidence. And you're really interested by that statement. You think, what is confidence? And it's just, confidence is confidence. It's, you know, it's this intertwining. It's not reducible to either of these strands. It's this complex intertwining. And I think, in a sense, that's what he was saying again yesterday when he was talking about the complex interplay between the three types of logic. So in a sense, I think there is a return, a sort of realization that what he did in being an event is not sufficient to explain that expression of the subject is applying the theory of the subject. So I think your work's really interesting. I think there's, you know, a lot to be done there. And especially to question that, if you like, that compulsion in Badiou, which is to go back to that rich expression and to try to formalize it every time, realizing it's not exhaustive, and try a new level of formalization and a new dimension of formalization. Mm-hmm. So I think there's, yeah, I like it a lot.
Thank you.
Is there
anything good
you want
to say?
I'm very happy with it. I'm not sure if my paper works, but at least I think it'll be something interesting to think about. So, in theoretical writings, Badiou states that there is a, quote, absolutely univocal character of being, end quote. And my paper wants to think about this. So it kind of looks at a lot of things that were talked about yesterday. But instead of focusing on the sort of technical sophistications of like the void or the inconsistent multiplicity, I kind of want to approach Badiou's ontology from a more broad stroke or perhaps naive viewpoint. Namely, that if Badiou's ontology is univocal, does it entail, or does the univocity of being entail that it is a metaphysics of the one, as we find in his critical portrayal of Deleuze? So the question is, whether Badiou is, after all, a metaphysician of the one. So whether Badiou's controversial characterization of Deleuze is accurate or not, from his critical account, we can observe like some key aspects of Badiou's own ontological commitment. Firstly, he describes Deleuze's philosophy as, quote, in no way a critical philosophy. That is, he sees Deleuze as a fellow colleague in presenting a re-emphasis on ontology against the dominant critical ethos of philosophical modernity, which claims like the end of metaphysics and all that stuff. And secondly, more specific than a general recasting of metaphysics, if you will, Badiou holds Deleuze, quote, a shared conviction as to what it is possible to demand of philosophy today, and the central problem that it must deal with, namely, an imminent conceptualization of the multiple. So both Badiou and Deleuze do not want to simply recast a pre-modern type of transcendent metaphysics, but instead develop an ontology of immanence. In this regard, Deleuze and Badiou kind of both make similar moves to overturn the ontological hierarchies of traditional metaphysics. So whereas Deleuze proclaims the ontological primacy of difference over identity, we see Badiou making his decisive preference for the multiple or the many over the one. So both moves can be seen as not only an outright opposition against the traditional metaphysical hierarchy which favours the one over the many, or identity over difference, but moreover, is a kind of overturning transcendent metaphysics itself, or what some identify as onto theology, in which the being of beings is theorized as a transcendent being by excellence, that which we often name God. So, as Deleuze writes in a passage heavily cited by Badiou's Deleuze book, quote, philosophy merges with ontology, but ontology merges with the university of being. The analogy of being has always been a theological vision, not a philosophical one. The university of being does not mean that there is one and the same thing, and the same being. On the contrary, beings are multiple and different. Whilst Badiou strongly opposes aspects of Deleuze's views in this passage, he shows with Deleuze here an anti-theological stance in his position against the metaphysics of one. As Peter Hall notes, the only possible ontology of the one, Badiou maintains, is theology. The only legitimately post-theological ontological attribute, by implication, is multiplicity. If God is dead, it follows that the central problem of philosophy today is the articulation of the thought, imminent to the multiple. Indeed, as Badiou acknowledges in his Manifestation for Philosophy, his Platonism of the multiple is fundamentally presupposes that, quote, God is truly dead. Whilst both Badiou and Deleuze show an anti-theological, or indeed anti-transcendent, emphasis on immanence in their ontologies, Badiou notes that they fundamentally differ on the issue of the one, to put Badiou at length. Whereas my aim is to found a Platonism of the multiple, Deleuze's concern was with a Platonism of the virtual. Deleuze retains from Plato the univocal sovereignty of the one, but sacrifices the determination of the ideas as always actual. For him, the idea is the virtual totality. The one is the infinite reservoir of dissimilar productions. In contrario, I uphold that the forms of the multiple are always actual and the virtual does not exist. I sacrifice, however, the one. Deleuze's virtual ground remains for me a transcendence that failed to hold thought firmly within immanence. So for Badiou, to truly overcome the metaphysics of transcendence and attain a genuine ontological immanence, one must affirm the multiple or the many and eliminate the one, or indeed any type of being by excellence. Deleuze's metaphysics remains, after all, for Badiou, one of transcendence, as Deleuze insists on the university of being, which resembles the traditional metaphysical regime of the one, what Badiou calls here the univocal sovereignty of the one. Thus, to quote Badiou again, it was exactly to avoid falling into this kind of predicament that, personally, I oppose the university of the actual as a pure multiple, sacrificing the one. But what is this university of the actual as a pure multiple that Badiou speaks of? Does Badiou subscribe to the university of being here? Does the university of being always entail the metaphysical sovereignty of the one? In his Deleuze book, Badiou associates university with Deleuze's notion of the clamour of being, which, as you know, Badiou uses as the book subtitle. And to quote Deleuze's original passage from Difference and Repetition, quote, there has only ever been one ontological proposition, being is univocal. There has only been ever been one ontology, that of Duns Scotus, which gave being a single voice. A single voice raises the clamour of being. Being is said in the same single and same sense of everything of which it is said, but that of which it is said differs. It is said different itself. Unquote. So in Badiou's reading, Deleuzean metaphysics is univocal in that Deleuze asserts that being can only be said in one single sense, that there's only one way, one plane of being. What Deleuze describes on the concluding page of Difference and Repetition as the single clamour of being of all beings. Now, as Badiou sees Deleuze's single univocal voice of being of the being of beings as constituting a metaphysical or indeed onto-theological structure of a transcendent one or oneness, one may question whether Badiou's own ontology also has a structure of oneness. So here I'm thinking about the opening meditation of being an event, and Badiou kind of makes a statement after decision to affirm the multiple and declare that the one is not. So here I'm thinking of the statement that Badiou goes, quote, ontology, if it exists, is a situation, and the A is emphasized in the text there. And to quote Badiou at length from that meditation, quote, If ontology, the discourse of being qua being, is a situation, it must admit a mode of the count as one, that is a structure. But wouldn't the count as one of being lead us straight back into those aporias in which sophistry solders the reciprocity of the one and being? If the one is not, being solely the operation of the count, mustn't one admit that being is not one? And in this case, is it not subtracted from every count? This may also be put as follows. There is no structure of being, end quote. But for Badiou, to pose that ontology is not actually a situation is actually what he calls the great temptation which must be resisted. Thus, he states quite strongly in Being an Event, quote, I will maintain, and is the wager of this book, that ontology is a situation, end quote. So whilst Badiou dedicates the rest of that opening meditation to take on the apparent paradoxes of ontology as a situation by axiomatically designating ontology as the presentation of presentation, as opposed to a presentation of being, his wager that ontology is a situation, one single situation, i.e. there is one ontology, seems to mirror Deleuze's claim that there's only ever been one ontology. So if you will allow me to cheekily describe Badiou's ontological proposition by paraphrasing Deleuze, there has only ever been one ontology, that of set theory, which gave being a single voice. A single voice raises the clamour of being, the clamour of the multiple. Being is said in a single and same sense of everything of which it is said, but that of which it is said is multiple, it is said of the multiple itself. So this was paraphrasing the Deleuze bit I quoted earlier. So one could indeed say that for Deleuze, whilst there is certainly multiples or multiplicities of beings, there is only one single voice that speaks the being of beings. But not dissimilarly for Badiou, whilst being qua being exists as the multiple, the voice or discourse of being qua being is still situationally one, or at least counted as one. Here I'd like to turn briefly to logics of worlds to think about the possible oneness or universality of Badiou's set theory ontology. Logics of worlds, as its subtitle indicates, is being an event too. So we can think of this as Badiou further developing his opposition against the one. His ontological project, being an event, is no longer one, but now two. It is now multiple rather than one. And this may be further supported by Badiou's assertion in Logics of Worlds that there are multiple situations which, as you know, are also called worlds, which are transcendently organized by different logics and all that. And so, in consequence of this, the ontology of being an event one is thus revealed to be, after all, just one among many, one world among many, that which operates under what Badiou calls classical logic. So, to quote Logics of Worlds, there is no whole. We will call universe the empty concept of a being of the whole. We will call world a quote-unquote complete situation of being. Obviously, since we show that there is no universe, it belongs to the essence of the world that there are several worlds. Since if there was only one, it would be the universe, unquote. So as there are many worlds or situations other than the single classical logical world of set theory ontology, Badiou, we can see as accordingly moving beyond the one single set theory, the ontological world of being an event, articulating a new ontology. So we can see logics of worlds speaking of a new ontology that is different, or we may say world apart, from the set theory ontology of being an event. And so we can say, for Badiou, just as there's more than one world, there's also more than one ontology, more than one voice or clamour of being. However, sort of recognizing ontology as a world of classical logic in fact reveals another way in which we can say that Badiou's set theory ontology possibly remains under, quote unquote, the univocal sovereignty of the one. As opposed to the non-classical logics that Badiou talks about in Logics of Worlds, Badiou's set theory ontology in Being an Event relies, as we saw yesterday, on a classical logic which presumes the law of double negation, which does not apply to non-classical worlds. So according to this law, proposition P is the same as the negation of its negation. P is not P and all that. And as we saw yesterday, this entails the excluded middle, according to which the proposition P is either true or false, is either true or not true. There's no between, there's no middle. There are no half-truths, if you will. the logic of this classical world of set theory ontology is articulated by, with binary numbers in logics of world, and in the way that you, so I'll just quote from logics of worlds here. So Badji puts goes, on the one hand, since not one equals zero, we have not not one equals not zero is equal one. On the other, since not zero equals one, we get not not zero equals zero. So we see here there are two values and not all options. There are no half-truths, there are no intermediary half-value of 0.5 or 0.1 or 0.0001 and so on. But as Badji remarks, this classical logic simply, quote, simply reiterates the founding discrimination of Parmenidean ontology, namely that being excludes non-being. This classical binary logic is in fact what underlies his decision in being an event to choose between the one and the many, and the multiple as binary opposites. For Badji, given that the multiple is, what is not multiple, i.e. one, must not be. Hence the decision, the one is not. Now this decision seems to propose a type of univocity, that there is only one way, value or value of being or beingness. Something either is or is not, being or not being. There is no half-being or half-way of being in between, just as something is either multiple, i.e. not one, or one, i.e. not multiple, from which one has to choose. So whereas there is a multiplicity, or indeed infinity, of degrees of existence possible in other non-classical worlds, the classical world of set theory ontology can only have one or zero. Essentially, it's only one that truly exists, as not or zero is technically not really existent and not a way of existing. But of course, as we saw yesterday, Badji draws a distinction between existence and being, but I think the reading here that I'm attempting illustrates a certain univocity of the classical logic of the set theory ontology. Thus, being an event set theory ontology only presents us with one univocal way of being, a beingness of one, or in Deleuzean terms, a single voice which raises the clamour of being. Being is said in a single and same set. So does being an event ontology therefore fall under Badji's own criticism, under his celebrated critique of the univocity of Deleuzean metaphysics? Is Badji, or at least the Badji of being an event, in fact, like Deleuze, a univocal ontologist, or even a metaphysician of one? Whilst one may say that Badji can avert these allegations of oneness by drawing on logics of worlds, I think a solution may also be found in being an event one. And being an event, the ontological concern of set theory is not actually the set. It's not what would be transcendently or transcendentally counted as one, but rather the elements or members immanent to the sets, as Horwood puts it. As Horwood points out, contrary to the dominant metaphysics of the one that counts from the top up, from top down, set theory ontology's, quote, conception of the set proceeds instead from the bottom up. Or as Badji puts it in Being an Event, quote, every multiple is a multiple of multiples. The essence of the multiple is to multiply itself in an immanent manner, just as in logic of worlds, Badji notes that it belongs to the essence of the world that there are several worlds. It is in this sense that set theory ontology speaks of an immanent multiple from the bottom up, one which Badji argues is more immanentist than Deleuze's ontology from the top down, a crypto-transcendent virtual. Here we find in Badji a different and more radical version of the univocity of being than Deleuze's, whereas the one and the multiple can coexist in Deleuze's ontology. For Badji, the one and the multiple cannot and must not coexist. They have an incompatible either-or relationship. It is because there is only one way of being, the univocity of being, that one must decide or choose between the one and the multiple. Thus Badji, in his own words, sacrifices the one in order to affirm the immanent multiple, whereas Deleuze leaves room for the existence of the one. For Deleuze, the one qua the virtual being of beings can coexist univocally with the multiplicity of actual beings, in line with Duns Scotus' original conception of the univocal existence common to the uncreated being of the one God and the created being of creation or of the many. So Gladue's ontology is thus more atheistic and anti-ontotheological than Deleuze's. There is only one way of being, and that beings exist. The being of beings cannot exist as a transcendent principle. There is no transcendent one or God or being of par excellence. This is not to say that Gladue forgets the Heideggerian ontological difference or eliminates the being of beings from ontology. Rather, it is the case that in his ontology, the being of beings is not a transcendent principle of being or being par excellence, but rather an immanent presentation. The ontological difference between beings and the being of beings, as Gladue declares in Being and Event, is precisely the one between presentation and the presentation of presentation. It is for this reason that Gladue's ontology is the presentation of presentation rather than a presentation of what. So underlying Gladue's formulation of ontology as a presentation of presentation, in fact, I would argue, or at least I would want to try and argue, is another universal being, a univocal identity between being, the multiple, and presentation. The multiple here is not only referred to as the general form of presentation throughout Being an Event, but Gladue precisely states that, quote, presentation is multiple being, such as it is effectively deployed, end quote. Indeed, given Gladue's ontology is at once the presentation of the multiple and the presentation of presentation, and that being is multiple, we can therefore deduce and postulate that being equals presentation equals multiple, univocally. It is precisely because being is univocally identical to the multiple, whose essence, as we already mentioned, is to multiply itself in an immanent manner. So therefore, the being of beings is in Gladue's ontology not transcendent, but immanent. As every multiple is a multiple of multiples, the intermultiple or interset relations in set theory are always univocal and never transcendent. Thus, Gladue's presentation of presentation does not have the structure of transcendence, but rather one of univocal relations, or indeed of immanence. So insofar as it is an ontology of immanence, Being an Event ontology assumes a radicalized univocity. Unlike Deleuze, it does not posit a univocal coexistence between the one and the many, but rather by way of the complete non-existence of the one, As the presentation of presentation, Gladue's set theory ontology postulates that being is univocally identical with the multiple. Being is univocally multiple. It is multiple all the way. Gladue's ontology is thus more radically univocal than Deleuze's, not only because it insists on the either-or incompatibility between the one and the many, but also that both beings and the being of beings are univocally multiple. Put differently, Gladue's ontology does not assume the alleged Deleuzian univocal sovereignty of the one, but rather the univocal sovereignty of the multiple. Whereas Deleuze's univocity affirms a univocal coexistence between the one and many, Gladue's radical univocity not only eliminates the one to affirm the many, but to the extent it insists that there is only one way of being, being is always multiple. So to conclude, Gladue's ontology is at once both univocal and multiple. Indeed, it is univocally multiple. Thank you.
Yes, we're in the circle, cried out soon. Questions? Yes, I think that would be.
It's a half thought, more than a question, but I'll hopefully generate a question. Thank you for your great paper. I know that you've done it to be controversial. Well, you haven't done it to be controversial, but it is a controversial paper. I guess I may have missed a step in your thinking. From the point where you acknowledge that there is a building from the ground up versus a transcendental from the top down,
in terms of how that then generates the reappropriation of this notion of the sort of the univocity of the multiple. I can't help but wonder whether perhaps we're getting stuck on the metaphor of voice.
Sorry, I'm not sure.
I'm not sure either.
The voice!
Siri's single voice. I suppose in a confused kind of way, Siri, thanks Siri. Don't we fall into a trap if we try to use the metaphor of vocalization to articulate mathematical formalization, precisely because the whole point of the multiple and the question of the one is one without predicates. And that is also to think of this idea that perhaps, again, we need to decenter this tendency to raise ontology to an ontotheology by virtue of making the central question, the question of being, in Heidegger's sense, and actually make the question of being one amongst many questions. Do you see what I mean by that?
Yes, and that was kind of what I was attempting to do with the logics of worlds bit, in a way, because there's just one among many.
Yeah.
It's not the world, in a way, in the end. It's just one among many. And so, but it's also, I guess that, and that was part of Professor Felton's thing yesterday, that like, to what extent, how important is ontology in the end? Because there's a certain uniqueness, and in a way, I can't help but think of it still a sort of such a special situation that it's not quite a first philosophy in the traditional sense, but there's still a tendency towards that, I feel, in declaring its uniqueness. But I think, again, and that's why I thought the paper yesterday, the presentation yesterday, kind of pointed, and I was trying to say a similar thing at the end, that by saying it's a presentation of presentation, rather than a sort of presentation of what or of being, in, or at least putting it that way, it's not elevating it. To a sort of transcendent level, and not to the extent of saying, because even within Duns Scotus, God is univocal, exists univocally like creation, but is still transcendent. So I feel like there's a danger there that I'm thinking of, whether actually you can say it's all, yeah, it's just a world among many, but it's still transcendent. But I think the presentation of presentation thing precisely tries to flatten it out and make it more imminent, in a way, if that makes any sense.
Any other points?
I didn't hear what Siri's response was.
What was the question?
If there's something else in there that we can talk over lunch, thank you very much.